So hello everyone to the seminar on Feynman integrals and Grothendieck-Teichmüller groups. Today will be a technical interlude on Tanaka duality. Which is a bit of a continuation of my last talk where I somehow explained where the ideas of fundamental groups and covering groups lead to fiber functors, which are an essential tool in constructing examples for this Tanaka duality. But now I'm talking about the theorem behind it, the big theorem, which is applied in these examples. Okay, so first I need to recall what the monoidal category is and make it very quick. So, definition of a monoidal category. So, it is a category together with a bifunctor, is category C. A bifunctor. Denoted by the tensor symbol going from C cross C to C. A unit object, we call it usually I, but I think Schiffmann and Ettinghoff usually call it C. So little c, small c, lowercase c. Then natural isomorphisms. Alpha A B C associated to three objects. Well, natural means they are associated to a functor, so the functor goes from C cross C cross C to C, namely tensoring three objects in this order, and the other functor is tensoring objects, the same objects in another order. And they should be isomorphic by this natural isomorphism. And also, well, as I said, it's a unit object and it's called like this because we have the categorical properties for units. So we need two other natural isomorphism. So the unit object tensored from the left doesn't change the object and up to isomorphism, and the unit object from the right tensor doesn't change. Okay, such that, and I'm not going to talk about this conditions, the pentagram diagram and the triangle diagrams. Commute for all choices of A, B, C, and so on. D. Okay. Then we had a tensor functor. Should put it higher up. Okay. This is better. Okay. Definition. Tensor functor well, it's a functor between monoidal categories, is a functor between monoidal categories. F going from C to some D. And for simplicity, I will denote this, the tensor functor in both categories simply by tensor. And
it's curly C and curly D, or?
Yeah, curly C, curly D. Yeah. Make it distinguishable from the objects and categories. And an isomorphism, natural isomorphism, J associated to objects X and Y, such that it relates, now I should check my notes, I'm forgetting the order. Such that we have isomorphisms like this. So this is the tensor in D, this is the tensor in C.
If it's not, there was a remark that some, if it's not an isomorphism, it's called that's what?
It's what?
It's like if there's not an isomorphism, they're just natural transformation, or don't you remember?
I don't really remember, but for me, I will require that this is an isomorphism anyway. So, yeah. And okay, since we talk about tensor functor and monoidal categories, we should also define what the tensor category is. A monoidal category which is additive or even K-linear for KR field, and such that both structures are compatible, which is additive, and structures are compatible, which means that tensors of direct sums are direct sums of tensors, so like a distributivity law and such things, given by some other transformations which I don't want to give a name.
So additive means it has a direct sum.
Has direct sums, and especially also, well, that's one way, so it always has a direct sum construction, which is functorial, or the other way you can view it is the Homm sets have an abelian group structure on it, which is compatible with operations and everything, with compositions, which are two equivalent notions. Yeah. And is called a tensor cut category. Okay. This is all I need. By the way, does one see to the top?
No, one doesn't see the first line.
Okay, but this, okay, this is not a problem. Good. so maybe I should state some versions of Tanaka duality theorems, which I'm not going to prove. So I will state three versions, two of them which are usually referred to Tanaka duality, and the third one is the version that we actually need. But maybe it's good for general background to know that this is not the Tanaka duality theorem which we are using, but there are many flavors. So theorem, Tanaka duality 1. So I rather state them rather informally, not in the categorical language. You also could state them in the categorical language, but I'm not going to talk about this. So for compact groups, G, say, compact topological groups, obviously, one can recover G from its tensor category of representations rep G representations in, say, C vector spaces. So what does this mean? Well, starting from two compact groups, I get two tensor categories like RepG and RepG prime. And those two tensor categories, which also have additional structure, when I consider the additional structure also, I can recover G and G prime, and I can recover G and G prime non-isomorphically when I started with G and G prime non-isomorphic. So yeah, so it's essentially an equivalence of categories what's behind this. And also we had some discussions about the Pontryagin duality and some extensions. So for locally compact commutative group, an analog statement holds, but then I can also replace representations, not with arbitrary C vector spaces, but with one-dimensional C vector spaces, which are called characters. So in the abelian case, I can weaken this to locally compact, and then one-dimensional representation characters suffice to gain this recoverability condition or property. Theorem two. Tanaka duality two. So so now I use some terminology about categories which I didn't introduce so far. I don't say what a neutral Tanaka category is. It's something like this plus additional data. So every neutral Tanaka category C omega, where omega is part of this of the structure, over K, a field. Is equivalent to a category. It's a tensor category, and I think it should be a rigid tensor category. So rigidity means that there are some duality properties. So that you have something like a dual, and this dual is compatible with the tensor structure. And then neutral. What does neutral mean? I think the identity object should be. Yeah, I think the endomorphism of the identity object should be isomorphic to K. That's, I think, neutrality then. But then I'm giving references, so you can check these references for really the proper statements. Is equivalent to a category RepG of now a finite dimensional K-linear representations of an affine group scheme G over K. So affine group scheme essentially is the same as a K-Hopf algebra, i.e. essentially K-Hopf algebra. What about them?
Because to talk about G, I think you have to suppose that the coproduct is co-commutative or the
No. I think you can do this, for example, for GLN. GLN is an algebraic group over K, which is affine.
Yeah, and what is it? The Hopf algebra that you consider?
It should be something like, so for GLN? GLN. It should be, so first of all, I need an algebra, and the algebra is commutative.
Ah, okay, so that's what I'm saying.
But not co-commutative.
No, I say either commutative or co-commutative, I don't know.
No. I mean it's commutative, but not necessarily co-commutative. The co-commutivity would associate to the group structure being abelian or not.
But I was saying that one of the two, either the product or the co-product, need to be commutative because you were talking about the space. That's the only thing I was saying. But it's okay. Yeah, you're saying it. You're saying that the product is commutative. Yeah.
Okay. So then I guess we don't need to talk about this. Or does anybody want to see how the Well, that's very easy, essentially. You do k adjoint x1, 1, x1, 2. So now I'm allowing myself to be sloppy. x1, n, x2, 1, and so on. x2, n until xn, 1, xn, n. So this is all the matrix coefficients. And then you have to associate another d. And what you mod out is, so D should play the role of the determinant, but the inverse of the determinant. So it's like mod out by D times the determinant in the Xi minus 1. So I take the determinant of Ij from 1 to n. And then D is the inverse of the determinant, and this is necessarily to construct the inverse for this group. So this is the algebra, and then you also have a co-multiplication and so on, which comes from the group structure. Okay. I promised references. So for theorem 2, my favorite reference is Tamás Samuelyi. And Galois groups and fundamental groups, and this is part of the Cambridge Studies in Advanced Mathematics, 117, chapter 6. Also, the classical reference is Deligne. And James S. Mill and others. In Hodge cycles, motifs, and Shimura varieties, lecture notes, and mathematics, 900, chapter 2. And for theorem 1 and also 2, well, there is also lecture notes and mathematics book by some editors. I don't write the editors. LNM 1488. The authors of the particular chapter are Joyal and Street. And this is part 2, which they wrote. And you can find materials there. Oh, and of course, all the talk, what now follows, is based on Ettinghoff-Schiffmann. So just to say, and once the rest of talk, Ettinghoff-Schiffmann. This is lectures on quantum groups. This is lecture notes and mathematical physics, but they don't seem to be numbered for some stupid reason. So here I write the title for a change. Lectures on quantum groups. Chapter 18. Okay. So if you really want to get down with these things, then you know where to find our stuff. The mic is good now?
Still okay.
Still okay. So no issues with batteries. Any questions so far? Nah. Any hand waving? It's actually good. If you do the hand waving, I don't need to. Maybe this is what you want to say with this.
Also, for the first theorem, you can recover the group from the automorphisms of the tensor function.
Right, this is the idea. But so the tensor function. To repeat the question, so the question was, how can I recover it? I recover it from the automorphisms of the tensor functor. And since the tensor functor is part of the structure, also the automorphisms are part of the structure. But then you also need some more things. This category of representation has some additional structure, and I not only need the automorphisms of the tensor functor, I need also to put some structure on it to really recover G. Now, where was I? Theorem Tanaka duality 3. So this is the version we actually need. So let K be a field. Let A be an associative unit K algebra. And C rep A. Well, you could put the K here, but yeah. The category of arbitrary dimensional A representations. In K vector spaces, so what are the objects, i.e. objects are K vector spaces V equipped with some representation rho. Okay, maybe that's not bad notation because rho we had also for the right co-unit thing, but okay, well. Different row here. Okay. And morphisms, the usual thing, so commutative diagrams with triangles induced by morphisms of V. And let F be a functor from rep A to K, the category of finite dimensional K vector spaces, be the forgetful functor. So we just forget about the rows. This is essentially why I wrote it, because then I really can say what we do. Then for any tensor structure, or tensor category structure on the C, satisfying certain conditions, namely F should be a tensor functor. So there is a natural isomorphism J with these good properties, which I had written on the arrays blackboard. Okay. there is a unique bi-algebra structure on A. Didn't recall what the bi-algebra structure is, but I guess I'm not everybody's familiar with this. Something like a Hopf algebra, but a little bit weaker. Such that the C tensor and rep A with the tensor structure given by the bi-algebra. We already had this in construction in previous talks. Are isomorphic or equivalent, say, as tensor categories. So there is a tensor functor from one to the other, which is an equivalence of categories. Okay. Well, I'm going to prove this. Lemma one. So what do we want to do? We somehow want to, we take this category, we have this forgetful functor, and we have a tensor structure making this forgetful functor a tensor functor. And from this, we want to somehow recover this thing here. So the first thing we want to recover would be A. And this is what we do in lemma one. With A and F as above, then F is representable by A. So we can recover A from only F, only as an A module first, but at least as an A module. Action from the left. So we can recover A as an A left module. How do we do this? So for X an A representation, we need to, I mean, we want to do something about F, so we need to think about what F does. For X and rep A, the underlying vector space is Fx. Yeah, right, this is what F does. It forgets the representation structure, only gives you the vector space. Okay, so let X be in a vector, so this. Then there is a unique morphism of A representation going from A to X, sending the ring unit of A to X. Because while A is free, essentially, yeah, it is the most, the best example of freeness there is. So it is free, so I can send a generator, G1, to anything I want in any other module, and I have a well-defined morphism.
Sorry, what A is
A as an A module is free.
Ah, as an A module?
Yeah.
Okay, yep.
Okay. So what does it mean to be representable? We need to rewrite this functor F in terms of a Hom functor. And we rewrite it via the action on objects A. So this is isomorphic to Hom rep A from A to X. Okay, so what I essentially showed you is how to get the map from F of X to this Hom set. But
sorry, but why do you need the small x, or is small x also there on the?
Well, so I need to, what does this isomorphism mean? We need to send small x is isomorphically stuff here. So call this morphism m small x. And this is what they do. I send m to m small x. So I really give you what this isomorphism is. So this is it as a map. So and then you need to check. Is bijective and satisfies morphism property as K vector space. Is K VS isomorphism. Okay. And then we are still not done, but I won't do this. I think it's not so hard to see this. So and then we are still not done. We also need to show that it's actually compatible with morphisms. So if I have two A representation morphisms, say from X to Y, then I also need to show that some F of X to F of Y commutes with this Hom rep AX to Hom rep AY. But it's also not hard. Check is a KVS isomorphism compatible with X to Y in morphisms of A representation. Yeah, and this is what representability says. I think Ettinghoff and Schiffman only comment on it like obvious. But maybe it's good to do a little rehearsal on what it actually means. Now comes the hand waving. By the way, how long have I been talking so far? Forty minutes, okay. That's about what I thought. Okay, so we essentially got the A module structure and A back from F. So now we want more. Of course, we want more. We want, for example, the algebra structure. Lemma 2.
Sorry, I didn't. Huh? Because what we did, we got an isomorphism between F of X and Hom from A to X.
Yeah. And we I also stated that it's compatible with morphisms of A representation.
Yeah, but why so is this, an A module then?
Huh?
Why A is an A module then? You said we got back the A module structure on A from F of A. That's what you said.
From the forgetful functor, yes. From the.
But we just got this isomorphism.
Yes.
So how A you see it as an A module out of rep of A?
Yeah, for example, if I If I substitute A here,
okay,
then I get the A representation homomorphism from A to A. And what are A representation homomorphisms from A to A? These are the module homomorphism from A to A. The module homomorphism from A to A are what? It's exactly the left action of the ring A on A, because hom AA is essentially A acting by left multiplication. So if I substitute A here, I get back all so any homomorphism here is of the this is just algebra. This has nothing to do with category theory or anything. So if I substitute A here, I get all the maps how A will multiply an element in A to something else in A. Say an element S in A. I want to know how S multiplies with a model element here. Well, multiplying is a module homomorphism, so it's an element in here, one to one, and this is how I to get back the module structure.
Why is it one to one? I understand that the left multiplication gives you morphism of representation.
That's algebra. That's algebra, maybe commutative algebra one. Okay, so should I prove this? I mean, this is not really part of what is needed, but. It's actually a rather elementary fact. So,
No, it's okay.
I mean, I tried to somehow make guidelines here. I mean, I'm stating some lemmas, and I tried to explain what their higher meaning should be or might be. In this case, we from step to step we recover more and more information about a module structure, no ring structure. There is a canonical isomorphism. Of K-algebras. Theta. From A. To. The endomorphism of the functor F. Again, I want to recover a structure on A from F, and so I take the endomorphisms. So what are the endomorphisms of a functor? So these are the endotransformations. This is a set of endotransformations. Yes, of from F to F. I mean, end has so many meanings. I thought I spell it out. What the objects, what the elements of this set are, and given by theta of small a. So this should now be an endotransformation. So I need to specify what the morphism associated to an object in rep A is. So this applied to X should be a morphism. It's LAX, which is left multiplication by A on A module or A representation. For any A in A and big X A representation.
So you're saying that you pick up X in rep A,
mm-hmm.
Then you forget what it is, so you just keep in mind the vector space and the line.
Mm-hmm.
And then you say that you want a linear map from this vector space to this vector space, which depends on A. And you say this is just mm-hmm. The left multiplication by A, or what?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, well, since there is an A module structure, left multiplication by A on big X actually, so gives me an endomorphism of X as A module. But in particular, after forgetting A module structure, it leaves me with an endomorphism of K vector spaces because A is a K algebra. And also X is a K vector space. So this is a K vector space endomorphism. Yeah. And this is exactly what I have to do. An endo transformation means I need to, for any X, I need to specify a morphism from the vector space Fx to the vector space Fx. And this is one such thing. Yeah.
So here you have defined the map theta.
Here I have defined the map theta.
But we have to check that it's surjective and injective.
Yeah, and we have to check lots of other things too. What? Algebra? There is an isomorphism of K algebras, yeah. Proof? Sketch? First of all, well-definedness. So I already argued that essentially element-wise it has a right form, but there is more to an endo transformation. So element-wise it has the right form. Would need to show for all or for any A in A and any phi going from X to Y. A morphism of A representation, I call it C. So for any such morphism, have a commutative diagram like this. F of X goes to F of Y. So here comes my theta AX going to F of X. Here is my theta AY going to F of Y. And here I have F phi again.
That's the definition of phi to be a map of A modules.
Right, because it has to commute with left multiplications by A. Follows immediately from phi is an A module or A representation morphism. Yeah, but we should never forget about this. I mean, there is categories gives us lots of algebraic structures, which is good because we can do a lot of things about this, but which is also a pain in the ass if we want to check that we actually have this. What? Yeah. And So next thing to check would be, first of all, homomorphism properties. Would need to check. Theta is a K-algebra homomorphism.
Definition of being a module, right?
What is the definition of being a module?
It's associativity of the left multiplication.
But don't forget we have endo transformations of a functor here. So first of all, we may need to make sense what the ring structure on the endo transformation of this type would be. Here comes in handy that they only sketch it. So in linear algebra 1, we let the students do all this nasty stuff. But I will don't bear to do it here. And now comes what Yael suggested to do. Bijectivity. So first maybe injectivity. This is really an exercise in linear algebra. So let A1 different from A to B ring element and set x equal A. So by the way, did you know that that there are actually ring isomorphisms which are not bijective? That there are ring monomorphisms, that's a ring epimorphisms that are not ring isomorphisms. I give you one. Anyway, so a ring isomorphism is enough to show that it's bijective. But in general, you have to be careful about this notion of epic, monic, and so on. Especially with rings. With module, everything is fine. But with rings, you have to be a bit careful in general. I'm coming from the algebra group, and I'm just a little minion in the algebra group. The cause of algebra, the more pervious stuff, pervious sheaf, for example. Set x the tautological left A module. So on this X, we not only have a left A-module structure, we also have a right A-module structure. For the moment, we forget about this, but it will come in very useful later or during this proof. So we need to apply theta to this. So if we apply this, we get an endo transformation of functors. So we apply this to an object X, and not any object X. We pick our favorite X object A. And so what do we get? We get something like this. So an homomorphism like that. So we apply the homomorphism to an element of this module. And what is our favorite module element in A? It's not 0. No, it's 1. Okay. So what's this? This is actually nothing, but by what we set this theta to be, the left multiplication of little a1 on big A, and we apply this to the unit element. So what do we get? Well, if we multiply a1 with 1 from the left, we get a1. Yeah, well, now we do this all backwards. This is not equal to a2 by our thing here. And this is lA2a. applied to one, and this is theta A2 applied to x applied to 1a. So obviously theta behaves differently when applied to A1, and or the result of theta is different, behaves differently when applied to A1 and applied to A theta. Injectivity. Algebra is fun. You do what's obvious. Now surjectivity. Okay, now surjectivity is a bit of a harder problem. So we need to pick an object in here, or an element in here. So let theta be an Ender transformation for F, arbitrary. So is the sound okay, or what's the issue?
Yeah, it's fine.
It's fine, okay. Well, not exactly. Well, yeah. Well, we already have renamed A to be X to look to make it more look like an element we would apply F to. So we apply it to X. But essentially, yeah. So set A theta, not theta, big phi applied to X. And then the same x as above,
okay.
And apply this to 1a. Well, what does it give us? It does give us an element of x equals a. Very fine. So this will be the candidate to which we apply theta to get back phi. Yeah. So first of all, we need to check that this I does first of all the right thing on our x equals a, namely left multiplication by a. So and this is where the right module structure comes in. So for a given b in a, look at RBX, X to X, descending X to X times B. Now multiplication from the right. And so this whole thing is, again, a morphism of left modules. Right multiplication is a morphism of left modules, because obviously it does commute. I can first do multiplication by left and then right, or the other way around. So it does commute, and that's the morphism property for left modules. So have phi of x at b. So we need to check that it does the right thing on all of x. So and it took some arbitrary b in a equals x. And we want to see that it's actually that this is theta of a applied to x at b. Yeah, so what's this? So b can be rewritten as the right multiplication of b applied to 1a. And to make it a little bit more fancy, I first think of right multiplication as a module morphism, and then forget that it's a module morphism and only it's a morphism of k vector spaces. As a map, it does the same, but I just forget a bit of structure. So now I use that what Ender transformation do, they commute with functors. So this is FRB now applied to the result of this thing. This was the diagram downstairs, essentially, but for phi, not theta. Now, again, what does this mean? So phi of x of 1a, that was what we said to be a. So this is just a there. And what's this? This is b times. So this is b times a times b. Sorry, you're right. Times b. B is right. Yes. So so this shows that phi of s is theta of a of x for one very specific x, namely this one. But what we need to do is we need to show that it's actually the same for any.
I miss one thing here.
Yeah.
So once I have these, what are you saying? So why from that you get that phi of x is theta a of x?
Okay, so well, this is you write multiply b with a.
Yeah.
So, but this is nothing but left multiplication of a at the object x.
Yeah.
Which is the a module a. Applied to b. So on this b, it agrees, and since b was arbitrary, for given b, obviously this is equal to that. When are two maps equal? Well, when they have the same domain and codomain, and when they have the same mapping description.
Now it's equal for x equal to a.
Right. So this is what I said.
Okay. So you were looking basically at the first term in the sequence of equalities. Phi x phi on b is theta a phi on x phi on b.
Yeah. Well, that's algebra. It's hard work, but it's obvious hard work. This is why you can be lazy and do hard work at the same time because you don't have ingenuity. Okay. So next thing to do it for x a to the I, and so direct sum, and I arbitrary so show the equality on all three modules, and then there's a theorem from Olga which I just quote then use well or then do it for a mod AI mod B for B arbitrary module. Well, and it's not so hard then because you have a generating set for this, an obvious one, and this is still a generating set after modding out B, and so I have to check the quality of these things on these generating sets and use that I. Yeah, it's essentially the same computations over and over again, but lifted to higher generality. And then any A module M is of form isomorphic to I machine. Essentially, you pick a set of generators here. You take for each generator an index, take a to the I, you get the morphism, a surjective, well, an epimorphism, surjective because it's monomorphism, surjective and epi are the same. And then you take out the kernel and that's it. And now we are done with lemma 2. So maybe I should write this down. Thus, phi is equal to theta of A for this A above, and thus phi is of them in the image of theta. I have a very vicious idea about you now. Vicious, yes. Evil. Yeah. Okay. So what do we want to prove? We want to prove this theorem. So we want the bi-algebra structure on A from the tensor structure compatible with the forgetful function and everything. Okay, so proof of theorem. There will be another lemma, so don't worry. So want a coproduct say delta from A to A tensor A. Need to construct it from F and compatibility. Okay. For this, introduce F squared sending two representations to the following thing. So well, what is C now? C now is our category of representations. So I can take the tensor product as vector spaces. And then I on this thing, I already have an A action, because on tensor products, I have, no, I don't. What do I have? Well, this is actually not C. This should be OK. Right. I do have this. Yes, I do have. So, and this will allow us to do to get to the delta. So first, I want to show that this F squared is something we more or less know. Lemma 3. We have that the ring of endotransformations of this functor F squared is isomorphic to NF tensor NF, which which is A tensor A by lambda 1 above. So now I will freely identify NF with A. Also remember that, so A was first an A left module, but we recovered the ring structure. So we could also say these are isomorphic as ring. So we can tensor the right multiplication to the right module structure of A as an A module with the left module structure of this A and get from this left multiplication left action on this and from this right. So this is again an A module at least, an A bimodule. And we can also have a ring structure on this, essentially by a component-wise multiplication. I only have an A module structure on this, but this will suffice. So this is only equality of A modules. This should be as.
So it's tensor over what? It's tensor over A or no? No, it's tensor over K on the right.
It's all tensor. Yes, it's all tensor over K. But they still have an A multiplication from the left and an A multiplication from the right. Also, I do on these things. Now I essentially do the same as in lemma 2 to show this. So what do we need to do? Here I just quote him. So how is this clear? Well, we just take endomorphism on both components. And we just let both endomorphisms act on each component. And this gives an endomorphism on the whole tensor product. So, well, then this element-wise, it gives us such an endomorphism. And then we need to do all this compatibility machinery with morphisms of F to F primes, W to W primes, and so on. Similar to what we already explained in detail.
You mean the three dots up there?
Which three dots?
On the top?
No. Actually, more the well-definedness, which was on this board and erased. So now we need to go back. For going back, let F be arbitrary and F and F square. Consider FAA. So at the place x equals 3, now I drop the x and just write A when I mean A as an A module. Going from A tensor A to A tensor A, now as K vector spaces. And so what we need to do now, we essentially need to show that this comes from something in there. So from an A tensor B. But this is essentially the same that we did already up there, including the dot dot dot. So, for example, what did we? So, consider FF. Need to show it comes from component-wise left multiplication by some A1, A2, element A tensor A. So if we've done this, well, what does it suggest? It means that this actually injects into this, and this you already know that this is this, so we get this composition of inclusion. But this is essentially what we already done. So do the same as above all over. So
you mean you apply it to an element one and you will get up with A1?
Yeah. So I apply this for the element 1A. If I do this, I get something A1, A2 here. This is exactly what I will set my A1 tensor A2 to. Then I will show that this whole thing is actually really given by left multiplication component wise with A1, A2. Fine, do it. Then I need to, when I did this, I need to do the direct sum construction. I need to do the quotient construction. And I need to make sure that in this C cross C category, we have similar issues like here so that I can write everything as quotients of free modules. And also check compatibility and that stuff. So it's the same, but twofold. And thus, so this is a bit of hand waving here, but is subset of A tensor A, which is and F tensor and F. And this gives the isomorphism. Of course, what you need to show if you start with something in here, do the similar stuff up there, and then do this, you get back the element you started with. So that's not, yeah. Good. So let's not forget what we wanted. We wanted a co-multiplication. So we wanted something from A to there. But this turns out to be that, right? And A itself turned out to be that. So if we now use identification, A equals NF and A tensor A equals NF square. We find delta going from NF, i.e. A, to NF square. Why? For A in NF and XY, A representations. We set delta A to be the following composition. And so so remember, F was a forgetful functor, but it was much more. It also was compatible with the tensor structure. It was a tensor functor. So what is needed in the definition of a tensor of making a functor a tensor functor? This is what I did recall at the very beginning of this talk. There is some J needed. So this is the place where now J comes into the view. Obviously we need it. I mean, otherwise I wouldn't have talked about it. It's algebra. It's you just write down what you need.
Maybe the white flag.
As I said, it's not hard. It's you don't need to. You don't need to. Phi delta. So it goes from fx tensor fy via jxy to fx tensor y. Now this is good because we have an A here. What does A do? A gets us from F applied to something.
Wait, by delta A, it's not J.
Huh?
Oh.
Sorry, I'm not finished. The following composition, it goes on. Okay. So what does A do? A is an endo transformation here. So for any object where apply the F to, it goes into its the same thing. So this is A applied to the object X tensor Y.
But I still don't get it. You want delta to start from on F and end up in on F square, right?
Yeah.
But here, yeah, the impression you start from on F square.
Right. I take an A. I take this A.
Okay.
And I want something which, for any object x, y, gives me something from here to.
Okay.
So as you said, I still need to go further. So I start with this.
Yeah.
And all this delta A, this will be an instance off in here when varying all over the object x and y.
Yep.
So now price question, what's here? Yeah, great. It's algebra. You do the obvious thing. Okay. So this is the definition of delta. Would need to check. Delta is co-associative. Co-associative. Skip it. But now at least we have defined delta and it has the properties, I assure you.
Oh, and that's really where we use the Monoidal structure, because you assume that you have a Monoidal structure on representation, so in particular you can take the product of two representation, it would be a representation, and therefore this A exists here.
Right, exactly. So yeah, this is the tensor on K vector spaces. This is A modulus, so A rep. And then we also need something else. We need a co-unit. Epsilon going from A well to the unit element which we have in A representation, which is the trivial representation on K. How do we do this? So A is still identified with NF, and what is K? K is this. Okay, so here I think we also need this stronger condition that this is the the unit element of from the tensor category. Tensor category also said we had this unit element z equal I in monoidal categories anyway. So we can apply f to it. And so what we do get is k, and the endomorphism of k as a k vector space or is k itself. And how do we give it? So we need to take such a piece like here. And yeah, we just send it to A at this. So what's this then? This is an endomorphism of K vector spaces, but this is isomorphic to K. So it's an isomorphism from K to K. And after fixing this identification, we know that one goes to something else is an element in K. So this is what it is. Yeah. So check is a co-unit. Co-unit. Done. At some point I said this is a sketch, so I'm really done because I sketched. And one remark.
Sorry, C is actually K.
Well, C is just a name for the unit object in our tensor category C. But this is essentially K, yes. K as the trivial module. K is a trivial A module.
It's the same K as on the left side.
F of and F of C isomorphic to K. Hmm. Yeah. Well, I just want to show where the concrete thing of having a representation comes in and where the abstract machinery of having a monoidal category comes in. This is this interplay between C on the category side and K on this concrete A representation side. So this is why I use both names, because, yeah. Concretization of an abstract concept. Now, one last remark. So, if I have braided tensor structure on F, i.e., there's compatibility with the swap thing, where we can swap x and y, and so we can have f x tensor y and f tensor f y tensor x, and there is the compatibility. This is braided. We have braided. Then we not only get the pi algebra, but get quasi triangulated. Algebra, i.e. bi algebra with some more additional structure. And yeah. That's essentially it.
So any questions? I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Why should I send my Christmas list?
I think here in Switzerland and everywhere on this world, you should send it to the Christkindl. So the Christuskind. This is a Christian country,
okay.
Not some American capitalist Father Christmas Coca-Cola owned country.
Okay. Well,